The Caramel Crème Cardigan by Web's design director Julie Turjoman is the perfect basis for this folk art-inspired embroidery. It's worked mostly in chain stitch. In this video, I'll show you how to work chain stitch on the cardigan using the structure of the fabric itself as a guide. In this project, we use a blunt tapestry needle to embroider, taking our stitches through the holes in the fabric, for example, the hole at the center of a stitch, or the holes in the gutters on either side of a stitch. We do not pierce the strands of yarn themselves. I prefer to begin a seam by first finding the hole where the seam will begin, then another hole about an inch away. The needle goes down at the second hole and up at the first. Pull the working yarn through, stopping when you have about 7 inches of tail from the beginning of the seam, that's your first hole, to the free end of the yarn. Doing this will keep your yarn tail out of the way as you work. Very convenient. We come up at the point where the chain must begin and then immediately take our needle back down into that same hole. Where our needle comes up again is important because that point is the point at which this link will end. In this case, we're going to go under two strands and begin to pull the needle through, and we come to a very important point in chain stitch. As we pull the needle through, the working yarn must be under the needle. We pull the working yarn through, and we find that we have made a loop, and that loop has caught on the working yarn. That's our first link. All of the other links in your chain are going to be very much the same. In order to work subsequent links, first take your needle down into that same hole inside the previous loop where you emerged, and bring your needle up where the link that you are making should end. Your chart will tell you where that ought to be. Make sure the working yarn is under the needle, and pull through, and your next link should catch. Continue to pull until the tension of the stitch is such that it's firm, not droopy, sits nicely on the surface of the fabric, but doesn't cause the fabric to pucker. Down into that same hole inside the previous link, working yarn under the needle, and pull through. And in this way, we continue our chain. Even tension and size from link to link will come with practice. In fact, I'd recommend that you try some practice stitches before you begin your project in earnest, just to get the feel of it. Changing directions in a chain is very simple, because when you change the direction in which your needle emerges in making a chain, you change the direction that that link in the chain will travel. On very curvy lines, such as you'll encounter in the hearts in the project, a good thing to do is remember that you always want to be working comfortably from right to left along your chain. So turn the fabric, as you see me doing here, to avoid bending your hands and wrists into awkward craning positions. So as we work and the work travels, we turn the fabric. We don't change the direction of our stitching. To end a chain, find a hole just outside the final link, about one strand over, needle down, and pull through until this final little stitch firmly but gently holds the last link in place. And then it's time to secure the beginning and end tails of this seam. As soon as I finish any seam that I'm satisfied with, I like to secure its tails on the wrong side. if you followed my anchoring procedure, the first thing you'll want to do is bring your beginning tail through to the wrong side. Very simple. Flip the work over, find the float between your first and second holes, put the tip of the needle under, pull through. The first way that I like to secure my tails is by wrapping the yarn around the back sides of your stitches. So thread your tail onto your needle, and then take a little stitch like so that should go just under the embroidery strand and pull through. Take a series of stitches like that in this same direction, under the embroidery strand. Sometimes you may go through the embroidery strand. That should work just as well, never fear. I like to do these wraps for at least an inch, maybe a little longer if it's a very slippery yarn. And if I feel very insecure about the staying power of a particular yarn, I may also seek to take wraps going back in the other direction as well. Although sometimes, as I just did here, I may undo that last stitch. Here we go, redo it. That's a little better. And continue like so until you feel secure until your yarn comes off the needle and you just feel like you're done with it. You can also secure a seam with a simple knot. Take your working yarn under the wrong side of one of your stitches, forming a loop like so, and then bring your needle up through that loop, pulling the working yarn after it, and then gently encouraging with your fingers, if necessary, the notch you've created to move down until it sits just on the wrong side of the fabric. I usually like to make at least two knots if I'm using a knot to secure. So once again, under the wrong side of that stitch, making a loop. If the loop curls up, undo it with your fingers until you can see what you're doing, where your needle is going. Then we take the needle here, upwards through that loop, and pull through, encouraging the knot down the strand until it sits on the fabric. Pull against your fingers and not against the surface of the fabric, because that might cause puckering on the right side. And then, whatever method you use, snip to leave yourself about a quarter inch or maybe a little more of tail. And there we have two methods for securing your seams. And they leave us with a nice, neat chain secure on the right side. Very satisfying. Now go and do your own.